Alaska Insight is supported in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by viewers just like you. Thank you.
Ballot Measure 1 has pitted environmental organizations against the oil and gas industry. It's also generated confusion among Alaska voters who are not clear about what a yes or no vote means. We'll look for answers this evening on Alaska Insight. Good evening. Tonight on Alaska Insight, we've got guests from both sides of the debate over Ballot Measure 1, the hotly contested Salmon Habitat Ballot initiative that seeks to protect habitat for salmon, other fish species, and wildlife. Both sides say it will be disastrous if they lose. Alaska Public Media's Elizabeth Harbaugh sought to get past the heat and shed light on this controversial measure and has this story.
Mike Wood is a small-scale commercial salmon fisherman. He lives on the Susitna River near Talkeetna. Wood is also a sponsor of Ballot Measure 1, a controversial initiative aimed at protecting salmon habitat, which will be on the ballot this November.
I've just gotten wrapped up into the whole fish politics of trying to get fish up through the inlet to here, to these creeks right here, so that they keep coming back. And that's kind of why I got involved in this.
I joined Wood on a boat trip on the Susitna to report a radio story on the initiative and hear why he thinks it's a good idea. The measure would toughen the permitting process for oil developments, dams, mines, and other projects built in salmon habitat.
The scale has been tipped too far in favor of development and industry, and we're just trying to pull it back towards the center is a monumental task, you know. But as long as it still exists and we have it, it's worth fighting for.
Alaska has some of the most valuable salmon fisheries in the world. Ballot Measure 1 supporters think the state's current permitting system is too weak, putting those fisheries at risk. If it becomes law, Ballot Measure 1 would make a series of changes to Alaska's system for permitting projects in salmon habitat. Among other things, the ballot initiative would create a two-tiered permitting system for projects in salmon habitat, with minor and major permits. Projects that could significantly impact salmon habitat would need a major permit and undergo a tougher vetting process. Alaskans would also get more notice and opportunity for public comment for projects planned in salmon habitat. And the ballot initiative would limit off-site mitigation. Today, developers can make up for damaging salmon habitat in one body of water by restoring habitat in a different water body. This measure changes that, requiring developments to restore habitat in the same water body. But Ballot Measure 1 faces a lot of opposition. I meet one of the measure's opponents at the Anchorage office of Doyon, an Alaska Native corporation. Kim Reitmeyer is executive director of the ANCSA Regional Association. She's part of a group of mining and oil companies, unions, Native corporations, and others campaigning against the initiative. Reitmeyer argues Ballot Measure 1 goes too far, potentially impacting projects that benefit Alaska Native corporations.
So this ballot initiative is so broad-based in the negative impacts that it outweighs what might be perceived as fish habitat.
Reitmeyer says Native corporations are interested in looking at ways to better protect salmon habitat, but she doesn't think Ballot Measure 1 is the right solution.
The red tape, the permitting processes, the comment periods could delay projects or cancel them altogether. And Alaska's in an economic recession. We can't afford to take another step backwards.
Ballot Measure 1 proponents disagree, saying most projects could go forward if it becomes law, but they would have to meet higher standards. It's a controversy that gets to the heart of what Alaska is all about. Should the state take new steps to protect one of its most valuable, iconic fisheries? Or should Alaskans reject the measure in favor of ensuring resource development projects can go forward? Voters will decide on November 6th.
Joining me now in the studio to discuss both sides of Ballot Measure 1 is Carly Weir. Carly is Executive Director of Cook Inlet Keeper, one of the organizations that is advocating for a yes vote. Hello, Carly.
Hello.
Also, Kara Moriarty is here. Kara is the President and CEO of the Alaska Oil and Gas Association, or AOGA, an organization that is advocating for a no vote on the measure. Hi.
Hi.
Kara.
Nice
Thanks.
To see you, Lori.
Thanks, both of you, for being here. So a question that I want to start out for both of you is, a lot of Alaskans might be seeing this as an initiative that is pitting salmon versus industry. Do you disagree? Do you agree? If so, why? Kara?
Well, first of all, thank you for the opportunity. It's good to see you, Carly. I think one of the reasons the oil and gas industry is part of this broad coalition is because the ballot measure has a lot of unintended consequences. You know, the supporters talk about responsible resource development and why that's important for the state of Alaska, and it is important. So this is not about salmon versus other industries. This is about what kind of permitting system do we want to have in Alaska that allows for balance, where we protect salmon and allow for responsible development to move forward. And unfortunately, in our view, the initiative just tips the balance where all projects in Alaska will be impacted.
Carly, your thought about, is this pitting salmon versus industry?
Well, I actually agree with Kara on this. This is not about salmon versus any other type of industry. This is about restoring balance. And from my perspective and the perspective of many of our supporters, right now the system is terribly out of balance in that it is too favorable to permitting large-scale mines without public notice, for example. And so this is an attempt to restore balance that balances proper protection of our fish habitat for future generations and responsible development now in Alaska.
So Carly, staying with you for a moment, the initiative changes the burden of proof for projects that could be built in salmon habitat. It makes the state presume a wide range of water bodies to be salmon habitat unless it's proven otherwise. Spell that out a little more. Why do you think that's important, and what do you think this may add regulatorily for projects that want to go forward? And then Kara, we'll hear from you.
Sure. Well, for example, I first learned about Title 16 permitting, which is what this initiative is really about, as I was learning about the proposed Chewitna coal mine on the west side of Cook Inlet. A local citizens group had to spend tens of thousands of dollars to prove that there were salmon in a stream that they observed and fished in regularly, that indigenous Alaskans, the Tabona people, the Tayonek tribe, knew there were salmon in that stream. But because it wasn't in the anadromous waters catalog, that citizen group had to put their hard-earned money, local citizens, into proving that there were stream in the fish, fish in the stream. The same thing happened in Bristol Bay. Bristol Bay residents know where fish spawn. They know where they spawn in these tiny little rivulets. And the Bristol Bay Land Trust had to go out and spend tens of thousands of dollars to prove what we already knew, that there were fish in this stream, so that those streams could be protected. So this does shift the burden of proof to industry, to development companies that want to develop in salmon landscape. Right now, the law presumes that there are not fish in the streams unless they are in the catalog. This flips that so that we presume that there are fish in the streams unless industry wants to prove there are not fish in there.
Carla, from industry's perspective, what do you think about that? Why shouldn't a developer have to make sure that a project isn't in salmon habitat before a project's built?
Well, I think the challenge with the initiative is it may have been intended for certain large development projects, but it's written for every single type of project. So the Department of Transportation actually holds the most fish habitat permits, more than oil and gas, more than mining. And so they have to obtain these permits for roads, culverts, airports, any type of work that we as Alaskans enjoy for public infrastructure. Individual Alaskans will be impacted if you have a dock or a culvert anywhere near freshwater habitat, anywhere in the state of Alaska. So to presume everything as anadromous now creates all this red tape for individual Alaskans and public agencies as well as industry. So the cost to add to these projects, the added cost, the added time, and then creating this also allows for a lot of opportunity for litigation in addition. So let's say the commissioner determines that there were no anadromous fish, that decision can be challenged in court now by anyone, even outside of Alaska. So trying to shift the burden of proof to those who want to obtain the permit actually shifts the burden to private citizens, public agencies, in addition to industry, because we already have to pay for those types of studies. It's really, the impact is much broader than just industry in Alaska.
Well, let's talk about that a minute. Carly, there are two, this creates a two-tier permit system. If it were to pass, there's major and minor permits. What projects would fall under each category, and how would this affect an average citizen that wants to do something along their shoreline?
Yeah, well, this is an example of where we believe the system is broken. Right now, the Pebble Mine would go through the same process as me as a homeowner if I wanted to put a dock on my property near a lake. That's unfair and that's not right. So what this does is set up a two-tiered permitting process so that large projects that would have significant and adverse effects in salmon landscapes are put into a different category, the major permit track. This major permit track sets certain parameters on how much harm can be done. It sets forth how these impacts could be potentially mitigated or avoided. It also provides a 30-day public comment period, which doesn't exist now for large projects. For the minor permits, which are a whole host of things, there are different ways that Fish and Game may issue these permits. For example, right now, Fish and Game issues general permits, general Title 16 fish habitat permits for transportation in rural Alaska, so that you can drive your ATV through a salmon stream and not have to go through the same process as the Pebble Mine. So what we're trying to do here is create a new set of mechanisms to hold large corporations accountable to their development projects, while also streamlining and making it easier for small projects that have very minimal impact to continue.
Kara, your thoughts on that? Does this ease the burden, having the two-tier system?
Actually, this creates a lot of red tape and increases the burdens for all projects in Alaska. You know, the state agencies have put out a frequently asked question document that I would encourage viewers to go look at on the state's website. Fish and Game has said activities such as stream diversions, culvert installations, replacements, and stream bank restoration projects may be categorized as major. So if the goal is to try to create an impact-only large-scale development, then the initiative should be voted down, because the initiative impacts all projects in Alaska. And that's why you see such a large coalition, including the AFL-CIO and their 55,000 workers, who are opposed to this initiative, because it is seen as very detrimental to any type of project and will be a job killer.
You were both on Talk of Alaska earlier this week. Carly, many Alaskans may feel that this, and have said that they feel that this may be an effort to just stop the Pebble Mine, that that's what's really at the heart of this initiative. How do you respond to that?
Well, that's not true. This initiative was not written for the Pebble Mine, but the Pebble Mine is an example of a new class of projects that are being proposed in Alaska. We haven't seen anything like the Pebble Mine before. The law that was written 60 years ago perhaps didn't anticipate a project in the scale of the Pebble Mine. So what this does do is set some very clear standards that the Pebble Limited Partnership must follow. And if they can't follow those, then they shouldn't get the permits that they need to develop in a salmon habitat area like Bristol Bay. So if you don't like the Pebble Mine, I think a yes vote is a very clear path for you in this initiative. But this initiative was definitely not written just for the Pebble Mine.
I think the challenge with the initiative, however, and I have no position on the Pebble Mine. The Stand for Alaska Coalition has no position on the Pebble Mine. However, existing projects like the Trans-Alaska Pipeline are not grandfathered. The head of Alyeska has said that this initiative will be put taps at operational risk, because it will be very challenging. They will have to get 70 to 80 fish habitat permits in 2019 under this new law, and it is very unclear how they will do that. It also impacts other large-scale development projects that I think most Alaskans support, like the AKLNG project. And the head of AKLNG has said it would be virtually impossible to permit that project. So I think, you know, the goal might be to create additional standards and some more public input, but we also comply with 18 other state and federal laws that do allow for a lot of public input on large-scale development projects. So for our standpoint, you know, that's the challenge when you put a very complex regulatory package on the initiative. You can only vote it up, you can only vote yes, you can only vote no. You can't just vote for certain provisions that you like and then, you know, reject other provisions that you don't like. So in its entirety, that's why our coalition is opposed to this initiative.
Let's talk a little bit about the public comment aspect of this. The measure, ballot measure one, would provide for more opportunity for public comment and notice, public notice for projects planned in fish habitat. Carly, why do you think this is important?
Well, it's a matter of transparency. Just last week, Alaska Department of Fish and Game issued 13 fish habitat permits for the Donlin Gold Mine without public notice, without posting them for people to view before they were issued, without providing an opportunity for local residents to comment on their permits, which effectively, in some cases, remove salmon habitat and fill salmon habitat for the duration of a mine. Which for the Donlin Gold Mine could be 50 years, it could be longer. So without that very basic level of transparency, how are we to know as Alaskans what is happening to our landscape, our salmon landscape, you know, at large? I think it's very clear from what we've seen in the lower 48 and in other places around the world that once salmon habitat starts to be lost in decline, it is very hard to get it back, if not impossible. The state of Washington is spending $5.5 billion over the last about 8 or 9 years to try to restore salmon habitat, and it's not working. So this is an attempt for us to put some common sense protections on development within the salmon habitat that we have and we're very lucky to have here in Alaska today.
The public comment and public notice aspect of this, your thoughts on that, Kara?
Well,
Anything wrong with that?
I think if this 8-page initiative was only to allow for public comment, I think we would be having a different conversation. The fact of the matter is we do comply with a lot of public notice for large-scale development projects, and the initiative, the way it is written, it creates a lot of red tape. You know, the Department of Transportation has said, and I'm just reading here, that it would impact road construction, airports, bridges, culverts, roadway embankment protection, stream realignments, as well as habitat mitigation, restoration, or enhancement. So it impacts all of the things that even DOT does, not just these large-scale development projects. So again, if the 8-page initiative only dealt with public comment, I think we'd be having a different conversation. But again, unfortunately, it was written so broadly and it impacts all these projects that will impact jobs in our economy. That's why we're opposed to the initiative.
I want to talk a bit about, you've mentioned unintended consequences mm-hmm. that you have concerns about. Mm-hmm. And one project that could fall under that area of concern is the Anchorage Wastewater Treatment Facility. AWWU has an EPA waiver, permit waiver, for that allows for primary treatment, not secondary treatment. It's one of only a couple in the nation that has that waiver. Could this, and Carly, I would turn to you first, could this initiative affect their ability to continue that waiver? They are adding their treated water into Cook Inlet that is not a salmon stream, but it does have salmon. And they're doing that into a mixing zone. And there are concerns about how this could affect mixing zone permits. What are your thoughts about
that? Well, there's two reasons why this initiative doesn't affect the Anchorage Wastewater Treatment Facility. One, this initiative doesn't affect marine or saltwater environments. It's for anadromous freshwater streams. The other reason is that right now, pollution discharges, such as what comes out of the wastewater treatment facility in Anchorage and in other places, are regulated by the Department of Environmental Conservation, DEC. They're the ones that issue permits and monitor pollution discharges. That would not change under this initiative.
And actually, you know, Carly, I just respectfully disagree. if you look at what the Department of Environmental Conservation has said, and I'm no expert on the AWWU waiver. I mean, I think that's a good question for them. But DEC has said that the changes in the initiative would impact ADEC's permitting and engineering plan review of wastewater discharges to all freshwaters in Alaska, and all discharges would be presumed to be ineligible for mixing zones and thus needing to meet water quality criteria at the end of pipe. So the way we read this is that they would not be allowed to discharge, whether there are other wastewater treatment facilities in rural Alaska that are certainly, that allow for mixing zones and freshwater, maybe even the one in Fairbanks along the Chena River, I believe is another, whether it's wastewater treatment facility there, right there along the Chena. We know that the Chena is spawning area for salmon, and that's a mixing zone. So according to DEC, the initiative would actually impact mixing zones.
Let me ask a quick follow-up about specifically this. The treatment plant in Anchorage discharges into Cook Inlet, mm-hmm. but two of their other treatment plants discharge into Eagle River and Glacier Creek. What about those mixing zone permits, Carly? Do you think that they may have a higher level of scrutiny and regulatory oversight now under this initiative?
Well, I am not an expert in this particular law, so I do not know the ins and outs of pollution discharge permits. But my understanding is that DEC is the regulator of pollution discharges, and that is not going to change unless they somehow want to give up that authority and delegate it. But my understanding is that that will not change under this initiative, and that DEC will retain their ability to issue permits for discharges into freshwater.
The challenge is, though, however, that the initiative does create, like we talked about earlier, this rebuttable presumption that all waters in Alaska are anadromous. And so DEC has said that mixing zones will not be allowed in an area of anadromous fish spawning. And so I think DEC is reading it that the initiative would impact their ability to permit in mixing zones.
Let's talk in the last couple of minutes, we only have a couple of minutes left, about offsite mitigation. I'd like to start with you and get industry's perspective in about 1 minute mm-hmm. on the concern about offsite mitigation, how this may be affected, and what that really means. What is offsite mitigation?
So offsite mitigation is when, you know, an agency is allowed to provide mitigation off-site. And one good example is, again, from DOT, that they utilize off-site mitigation right now, for example, in airport construction. So they want to create mitigation efforts in fish spawning areas, which attract birds off-site where that runway is going to be. And, you know, they have said on-site mitigation for airports will be very challenging and cause a safety concern if that's the only place they can mitigate for a runway is on site. So now all of a sudden you may be attracting birds to that runway versus off-site like is allowed today.
Carly, the prospect of off-site mitigation, which means if you're filling in a wetland here, you may have to go somewhere else. Currently under law, you can go somewhere else and restore habitat in a wetland. How do you interpret this under the ballot measure one?
Well, one, this is an area where Department of Fish and Game can have some discretion on what this means. The way offsite mitigation or mitigation works in general right now by the Army Corps of Engineers, for example, until recently, you were required to do mitigation within the same watershed. And so, for example, to mitigate for the Donlin Gold Mine, they have recently purchased conservation easements in the Chewitna watershed in Cook Inlet versus the Kuskokwim up north. And that seems like a bad idea because we want healthy, whole, intact ecosystems and watersheds in specific regions. But for an airport, for example, within a watershed is a very large place. The Cook Inlet watershed is gigantic. And so the opportunity for offsite mitigation within a whole watershed is pretty open.
We'll have to leave it there. Thank you so much, Kara Moriarty with AOGA, Alaska Oil and Gas Association, President and CEO, and Carly Weir with the is the executive director of Cook Inlet Keeper. Thank you so much, both of you, for being here.
Thank you.
The concept sounds simple: protect habitat for fish and wildlife. But complex questions about how Ballot Measure 1 could affect industry projects in Alaska are still being debated, and likely will be right up until Election Day on November 6th. Each week on Alaska Insight, Alaska Public Media goes into the community to go beyond the headlines and provide perspective on the issues that have Alaskans talking. You can watch past episodes of Alaska Insight online at alaskapublic.org/alaskainsight or stream them on AK Passport. You can also engage with us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Your comments will help us determine future topics of discussion. We return next Friday at 7:30 p.m. for a discussion with U.S. House candidate Independent Elise Galvin. In the meantime, stay informed and connected by listening to your locally owned and operated public radio station. Thanks for joining Alaska Public Media for this edition of Alaska Insight. I'm Lori Townsend. Good night.